sponsored by the Georgetown University Alumni Association and Alumni Career Services. Thank you for taking the time to join us today. My name is Sarah Hay, Associate Director of Alumni Career Services, and our presenter today is Laura Labovich, CEO of the Career Strategy Group. And we're so excited. Today's webinar has been very well received by our alumni community. We had over 530 alums sign up. Obviously, we aren't happy to hear that that many of you want to leave your jobs, but we are glad that you're joining us today, and Laura has a lot of exciting information to share. But before I turn it over to her, I just want to share a few housekeeping tips and reminders. Today's presentation is being recorded, and you can access the replay of this webinar within 3 business days on our YouTube channel. To access, just go to youtube.com and search Georgetown Alumni Career Services to check out over 250 archived videos from past sessions, including one that Laura did last year. And I also sent out that link directly in the chat area. There are 2 audio options. You can listen via your computer speakers or dial into the conference bridge number provided. Participants are not required to have a headset, but you are welcome to use one. It is important to note if you experience audio difficulties while listening via your computer speakers, this can be caused by having multiple software applications open. Feel free to close some of these applications or simply join us via the conference bridge number provided in your reminder email. Questions are welcome. Please type your questions into the question area on the GoToWebinar control panel, and Laura will plan to answer as many questions as time will allow during the Q&A portion at the end of the presentation. Afterwards, I will email everyone a copy of the presentation deck, so don't feel like you have to write everything down. And if you're having any technical difficulties, please submit those concerns to me via the chat area or visit the GoToWebinar support page. And without further ado, I'd like to tell you a bit more about our presenter. When job search management expertise as an award-winning career innovator and resume writer, master networker, and Fortune 500 corporate insider with flagship firms such as the Walt Disney Company and America Online, Laura Labovich is affectionately referred to in the media as a job seeker's best friend. CEO of the Career Strategy Group, a boutique career management and outplacement firm headquartered in Bethesda, Laura's contagious enthusiasm and powerful methodology make the perfect recipe for getting job seekers unstuck in their job search. Equal parts kick-butt trainer and nurturing cheerleader, Laura empowers job seekers to develop proactive, targeted job search marketing plans that increase momentum and achieve breakthrough results. Laura is the co-author of the book, 100 Conversations for Career Success, Learn to Network, Cold Call, and Tweet Your Way to Your Dream Job, and that's a book about what to say and how to say it in your job search, which was a 2013 top career book selection by Forbes. And we'll be sure to point you in the direction of Laura's resources at the end of the presentation, so you'll be able to check all of that out. Laura, I'm now going to turn it over to you. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you so much for having me, Sarah. I am so excited. Hi, everyone. Just wanted to say thank you so much for taking time out of your day. I know you're all super busy and, you know, giving me an hour. I'm truly grateful. I promise this will be worth your time. I'm thrilled and honored to be speaking to all of you. We have a nice big group. And whenever I do webinars, I really, really make it a point to give some really meaty information. So this isn't going to be just a sales pitch. It's really, this is the most important information that I typically coach on. And I've been doing this 8 years. And when my clients come to me, this is often the biggest challenge they're having, is they are applying for a lot of jobs and they're not having any success. And they could have the most beautiful resume, they could be a powerhouse at interviewing, but the problem is no one is responding back to them. So today what we're going to talk about is how to get a job without applying, how to circumvent that application process and get a job. So you probably have heard of the term the hidden job market by now. It's all over if you've done any kind of job search research. You've heard the term the hidden job market. And the hidden job market just means that very few jobs are actually posted. But that's not actually true. So we've sort of recoined the phrase in the job search or career coaching world to the gated job market. According to the Bureau of Labor and Statistics, I figure I should get the statistics out of the way for those of you who love data. The gap between advertised jobs and actual hires was 14% in 2012 and 13% in 2014. So essentially, the people who got a job by applying to a job is going down. It was 20% before, it was a little bit higher than that, but now it is going down, it is declining. So even though there are a lot of jobs posted, people are not finding a job this way. And unfortunately, job seekers are spending an alarming 75 to 100% of their job search time applying to online jobs. And so if you're one of the people on the call and you have been, you know, sort of look like the Home Alone kid with your hand on your head and your hair sticking straight up going, oh no, and you're applying to all these jobs, you have a good resume, you think you are qualified for many of them, and you're just not hearing back, I just want to speak directly to you right now. That is counterproductive, but it's not something, there's nothing wrong with you. Okay, this has nothing to do with you. And so even though you may feel that it's personal and that you're applying to all these jobs and no one's writing you back and you're getting rejection letter after rejection letter, I just really want to assure you that the process is broken, but you're not. Okay, this is really important to know. Applying for a job, crossing your arms and waiting simply doesn't work. It doesn't work, period. So what are we going to do about it? Well, I'm not going to tell you to stop applying for jobs entirely, because I know from being a former job seeker and from coaching job seekers that it's kind of fun, you know, to hit send and feel like you've accomplished something that day. And so I'm going to say it's okay to do some of that in your search. You know, maybe 5 to 10% of your search can be used applying to jobs. What I'm going to do today, though, is I'm going to show you another option, a better option, something that's far more effective. But just a little story. In 1978, there was a brilliant man named Xavier Roberts, and if you've ever heard that name, you know what I'm about to talk about. He was an American art student, and he conceived of one of the most popular toy fads of the 80s, and my favorite toy of all time, the Cabbage Patch Kid. And the Cabbage Patch Kid was a child that was born in a cabbage patch. It was almost too fantastical to believe, and I, along with every other girl in Farmington Hills, Michigan, where I grew up, we all wanted one. The problem was that parents across the U.S. had flocked to stores to try to obtain one of these elusive Cabbage Patch Kids for their children, and fights were erupting all over malls all over the United States, and you just could not find them anywhere. So by the holidays, there were none to be found. But my mother was in the gift business, and she owned a store called Mostly Gifts, since it's gone out of business, but she owned a store called Mostly Gifts, and she had a lot of connections to toy manufacturers, and so before the holiday season, long before the holiday season actually, she got wind of these Cabbage Patch Kids, and she was excited, and so was I, because I couldn't actually have any stuffed animals. I had a lot of allergies as a youngster, and I really, really wanted a Cabbage Patch Kid. So she called up a friend of hers at a toy store in the neighborhood, and she said, hey, I just wanted to know, if you get any Cabbage Patch Kids, can you pull one aside and save one for my daughter? And they did. So holiday comes around in 1978, and I unwrap my package, and it's a beautiful Cabbage Patch Kid, and I name her Carrie Ann, and I loved her like you wouldn't believe until I was 16, and I donated her. And now somebody else gets to love her. But the bottom line to that story was, you could not get a Cabbage Patch Kid if you went through the normal channels. If you went to Toys R Us and waited in line where they were supposed to have Cabbage Patch Kids, you wouldn't find one. This is very much like the job search today, the gated job market. Even though most jobs are not hidden, meaning they're posted, that doesn't mean that they're actually available. Okay? Accessing these jobs is still not easy. And you need to have a key code to get to the door, or a bouncer at your favorite bar. Think bouncer. Or you have to have a mom like mine who would go to lengths to try to find a Cabbage Patch Kid where there were none. Insiders get hired, and so people, they hire people, not pieces of paper. So when you target job openings, you are actually competing against, one, a job description of which you may not match all of the criteria, and two, you're competing against 75 other candidates. And so looking at those open positions as if they're really open is a misnomer. They're not open. They're not really even available. There's probably someone who has already gotten to the door, who has already met with someone in that organization, either through an informational interview, either through networking, either through a friend, and they are primed for that position. So instead of targeting job openings, we're going to target companies. We're going to target companies instead of job openings, and this is how you're going to spend the majority of your job search time. I want to tell you another little story about how to create this kind of buzz about you before you walk through the door. Because the key here is not waiting for the job to open. And so how do you know what companies to go after? How do you know who's going to open a job? Well, at the end of the day, you don't. You don't know who's going to open a job. But you do know the kind of job you want, and you do know the kind of company that would generally hire someone like you, and you do know where you live, and you do know where you want to work. So you know a couple things that are sort of fixed variables. And given that information, you can make a target company list. So I had a friend in AOL named Pratik Alsi, and I just talked to him last night, actually. And when I worked at AOL, I managed the college recruiting and internship program. And it hadn't launched yet, and we got a call from Pratik. And he was maybe 19, 20, I can't remember. He was young. And he wanted to work at AOL. And so he scheduled a meeting with us. We weren't hiring at the time, mind you. And he scheduled a meeting with us, and he totally wowed us. It was not an interview. It was an informational interview. He said, "Laura, AOL is where I want to be. I know you're not hiring. I know you're not hiring right now, but this is where I want to work. I'm absolutely sure of it." So we actually had him meet with my boss and with other people around the organization. But unfortunately, there wasn't something for him at the time. So what? So what did he do? Well, he got a job somewhere in the neighborhood, and the next summer, guess what he did? He came back, and he was interviewing with us again, informational interview. Finally, this time, he had met so many people in the organization that what happened was they did open a position, but not just one. There were multiple positions, and the divisions in the company at AOL were fighting over Pratik Alsi. He had made it such an effort to basically say, "This is the only company that I want to work for, and I know you're not hiring, but when you do, I want you to think about me." So even though we ended up posting those positions to the outside, they were never available. They were always primed for Pratik Alsi. I guess what I'm trying to say is I want you to all be little Pratik Alsis. But here's how you do that. So most of the time, you know, you hear, you know, the resume is the most important document in your job search arsenal. And I'm here to tell you that that's not true. It's not true. I'm going to give you another document that's even more important in your job search. And here's why. First of all, if you have ever, I know that's hard on a webinar, I know no one can talk to me, but in my experience with job seekers, you know, often they, you know, will have a resume and it's beautiful and it's really customized and it's professionally written, and you send it out to your friends and they say, of course, what are they going to say? They're going to say, "I'm going to circulate this around. I'm going to get this to someone important for you." But nothing happens. And you wait and you wait and still nothing happens. And the thing is, they're not malintention. They want to help you. They certainly want to do the very best they can to help you find a job, but they don't know how to get a job. They don't know how to help you because they don't know exactly what it is you want to do. So instead of a resume, the important document to have in your arsenal is actually called a personal marketing plan. Instead of saying to a colleague at like a barbecue, "Here's my resume. Will you take this and circulate it around," and then find out that nothing actually happened to that document, you're going to create something called a personal marketing plan, and it's going to create opportunities for you to land high-quality leads. High-quality leads. How do you do that? Well, you get really, really specific and very clear on what it is you want to do, what industry you want to do it in, what level you want to be, and what location you want to work in. So here are the things that go on a personal marketing plan. First, the job level. Do you want to be a VP? Do you want to be an SVP, a director, etc.? Do you want to be in marketing, public relations, government relations? Where do you want to work? What kind of function? What geographic region do you want to work in? DC, Southeast? Do you want to work in the Midwest? Where do you want to work? Target companies. This is the most important piece of the personal marketing plan. And this is, and there's a reason for that, and I'll explain it in a minute. And then an industry of preference. And some of you on the call may say, you know, Laura, I don't care what industry I'm in, and I totally get that. Unfortunately, the employers that you are targeting probably care what industry you want to work in. And if they were interviewing two candidates, one in marketing and another in marketing who has really focused on manufacturing, and that person can speak to the passion they have around manufacturing or publishing or consumer products or any other industry, then that person is definitely going to get a leg up. Okay, so then in addition, you can also put on your personal marketing plan target company attributes, things like lots of promotion potential, casual Fridays. I don't know that I'd put that on there, but this is something that some people, it's important to. And then target accountabilities. So things that you've done, responsibilities, the impact you've had, what you really want to do as you move forward into your next career. The reason this personal marketing plan is so important is because if you go with the first example of taking a resume and submitting it to a friend and asking them to help you circulate it around, they really want to help you, but they don't know who to get it to. They're just not sure who to hand that resume to. But if you say to them, here's my personal marketing plan. I really want to work in one of these target companies in this industry or in this industry in the DC area, and here's the level that I'm targeting, and here's the function. Can you introduce me to anyone in these companies? I'd really appreciate it. And then I actually think of this like a tennis match, right? Because the goal is you actually always want to keep the ball. So if someone says to you, you know what, I'd be happy to introduce you. Why don't you send me your resume and I'll get it to so-and-so at Discovery Channel. Your goal would be to say, great, I would love it if you could introduce me to someone at Discovery Channel. And here's my resume. But you know what, can you give me their information so I can follow up with them at the end of the, you know, after you've talked to them? So the goal is you want to keep that lead in your corner. You don't want that ball to go over the net, right? You want to make sure that you're always in charge of your job search and getting leads, getting information, getting, you know, contact info. That's going to keep you in charge, not sending your resume out to someone and not knowing where it's going. So this is what a personal marketing plan looks like. And this is, again, the most important document in your search. So if you're trying to replace the time that you spend applying for jobs, which we're going to not do anymore, we're going to, or not do as much, and we're going to focus on going after companies, not jobs, but companies, and contacts at companies, then the first thing you need to do is lay it all out on paper. And a lot of my clients, when they come to me, they say, but I do have a target list of companies. And so we go through it, and they say, you know, my target list is, you know, 5 companies deep, or 10 companies deep. At the end of the day, I'm going to just be really honest with you. If anyone on this call has a target company list that is less than 30, really 30 to 45 is the goal, you're not targeting enough companies to get one job offer. I'm going to say that again. It's really important on your target list, number one, to write down your target list, and number two, to have at least 30 to 45 companies on your target list. If you're targeting companies, you essentially don't know when they're going to open a job. Okay, you're kind of going in the dark. But the goal is you're going to try to get into these companies to make connections, to have meetings, and eventually with 30 to 45 organizations, you're going to start to create this network, this web, if you will. If you think of a spider web, it's like a web where you meet someone in the company and you have a really good relationship with them, and then you ask them if they'll introduce you to someone else in the company, and then they introduce you to someone else. Eventually you become that person that is buzzing around the organization, so that when the position opens, you will get a seat at the table to interview for it. So again, you're going to get this presentation, and I really encourage you, I'll actually send out also a personal marketing plan sample, so you can use this as a template, and complete this, fill this out for your target level, your function, your geographic target, and your companies. If you can slice it also by industry, fabulous. That's really great. That's ideal. If you're not quite there yet, No worries. Just target companies and move towards industries by researching what industries make sense to you. This could be a hobby that you like or something you're just passionate about or an industry that you've worked in the past. Ideally, you would have an industry or two. That way you can keep your pitch very focused, right? Your focused pitch on here's the level I want to work at, here's my function, here's where I want to work, and here's the industry that I want to be in. But if you're not quite there yet, no worries. So let me take a step back for a second. If you cannot answer any of these questions on this personal marketing plan, for example, target job function, if you're saying, you know what, I'm just going to take anything, let me tell you, that's actually counterproductive as well. Because recruiters, they often have 70 to 100 positions that they're recruiting for and 75 candidates for each position. And so if the message is not clear on your resume, what job it is that you want, they're more than likely going to pass you over for a job. So you really want to be clear, make that message clear in your personal marketing plan and on your resume. Okay. So here's the protocol for accessing these jobs that are open but not really open because they're slated for a candidate that someone on the inside already knows. So how do you become that candidate on the inside? First, you must complete your personal marketing plan. That means writing it down, committing it to memory, bringing it with you whenever you go anywhere. I had a client who had a conversation in the grocery store last week, pulled out her personal marketing plan and said, here are the companies I'm looking to get into. And believe it or not, that person knew something and was willing to make an introduction. One thing to remember, if you don't have a personal marketing plan, your job search really has not yet begun. Get ready, because once you have it, you're going to really get higher quality leads. You'll enable people to understand what it is that you want better, and your job search will get momentum. Go after companies and contacts and not job openings. So again, this is the same thing. I really want you to stop focusing on applying to jobs online or even applying to open positions. Just assume that they're not available. And if you apply to them, forget about it and try to get in another way, okay? The next goal is to solicit meetings with people in your target company who are one or two levels above you. I know this is harder than it sounds. So for example, let's say you want to be a marketing and communications manager at Discovery Channel. I always use that as an example. I seem to get a lot of clients from Discovery Channel. Marketing communications manager at Discovery Channel. Well, then you would likely be reporting to a director or a senior manager. So those are the folks you're going to target, senior manager or director in marketing at Discovery Channel. But let's say you ask around. You go onto LinkedIn and you give your list to all your friends and your colleagues, and they know people at Discovery Channel, but they don't know anyone in marketing. That's okay. That's okay. You take that meeting and you talk to that person, and there's no job. So you're not talking about a specific job in that case. You're talking about what is it like to work at Discovery. And at the end of the meeting, if you've made a good connection, which hopefully you would, especially if it's a referral, you ask that person, would you mind introducing me to someone in the marketing department, maybe a senior manager or a director? And if they know that person, I'm sure they'd be happy to introduce you. That is a process called surrounding the hiring manager. And that process creates buzz about you even before the job is open. So during these meetings, also called informational interviews, what do? Well, the first thing is you don't ask for a job. You don't ask for a job because there is no job. And so you really want to just talk about advice and insight and recommendations, even referrals. I know that many of my clients and many job seekers will take their personal marketing plan with them, and they will actually adjust it each time they have an informational interview by putting the company they're meeting with right at the top in the top slot. But they'll say, here's my personal marketing plan, and I really appreciate you meeting with me. You know, since there's nothing available right now, I know you offered to help me. Would you mind looking at this personal marketing plan and letting me know if you know anyone in any of my target companies? Obviously, I would love to work for you, but there's no job right now. And so if you can help me get into other organizations or meet more people around this company, I would truly appreciate it. Again, you're asking for advice, advice on the industry, advice on the company, insight on potentially if you're, you know, if you're new in the industry, you could say, what are you reading? What trade journals do you read? What associations do you belong to? You know, who do you hang out with? Because it's important to really become an insider. And any recommendations they have of suggestions of moving forward with the companies that you want to work with. So this is just an acronym of AIR. That's what you do in these meetings. Again, don't ask for a job. To find the companies that you want to be, that you want to meet with, you're going to search for industries, company of interest, people within companies. So there's a lot of research that goes on in the gated job market. And I'm going to explain to you what to do next. To identify target company, the first thing you want to do is write down what's in your head. Okay, there's probably 5 or 10 companies already in your head that you know you want to work for. So write those down first on paper. And then segment them. Are they in the same industry? Are they in different industries? What industries are they in? And then look at those industries and say, you know, are any of these industries more or less important to me? If the answer is yes, and you decide consumer products, for example, is exactly where you want to be, then you go to the library and you ask the librarian for help on a specific industry and companies within that industry, and they can help you. You can look to your hobbies if you can't decide and pursue companies that are aligned with your interest and your passions. You can explore social media by identifying companies of interest and then using an advanced search feature, like on LinkedIn, for example, to find people who work there. And then use other tools such as Reference USA, Wet Feet, and The Vault to find organizations that are of interest to you. But the thing here is you just want to get a list of companies that you believe are a good fit for you. And also, this list is not static. It's going to change again and again and again. As you go on your informational interviews, you're going to determine that there are companies you just don't want to work for, and that's okay. So just cross those off your list and leave yourself openings for others. You may go to an informational interview and someone may say to you, oh, you absolutely have to apply for it. You have to, not apply, you have to consider this company on your list. And then you put that company on, do some research on that company. But the first thing, again, just creating a target company list and putting it down on paper. The next thing to do is identify people. So now you have this personal marketing plan. It's just a one sheet piece of paper. You're going to pair it with your resume. You're going to start taking it around with you and asking for these high quality leads. But who do you go to? Who do you go to ask for these leads? Well, the first thing you do is you go to your friends, go to your family, go to your neighbors. You can go to your high school alum friends, your college alums, your former colleagues, parents from your kids' school, religious institutions, people you exercise with, people you bowl with. The list can go on and on and on. What I have often done is I will, you know, go to LinkedIn and I will search all of the companies on my list. You know, there's 30 companies, for example. Plug each of them into LinkedIn, into the search field, and see if you have any first or second connections at any of these companies. Obviously, if you have a first connection that you didn't know of, that's a perfect place to start. Put that person on your list. If you have a second connection and you know that you have a good relationship with the first connection, that means the person you're connected to, the second connection being the person they're connected to, well, then you can put that person, both of those people, on your list as well, because you're going to need to reach out to them if you want to get more information about that organization. But this list really goes on and on and on. I mean, you could ask anybody on your LinkedIn connections if you wanted to, if you have a decent relationship with them, for a lead to any of your target companies. Then you want to get meetings. And so now you have, again, I'm going back, you built the personal marketing plan, you have your resume done, you have a list of people that you know at some of these target companies. You may even have a lead and a friend who said that they will introduce you to someone. And so you go after that person and you say, hey, I'd love to talk to you. You know, I often say, especially if it's an important person at one of your, you know, tier one, your favorite target companies, I would say, listen, can I come in and meet with you in the morning? I'll bring you coffee or I'll bring you a donut. People don't like donuts these days too much, though, do they? Bring like a latte that's sugar-free. How about that? And then during this meeting, You just want to share a brief summary of your experience, strengths, and interests so they know who you are and where you're coming from. That's the first thing you need to do. Then you want to ask focused questions to help you clarify your goals and fine-tune your targeting strategy, generate new leads and contacts. So maybe asking questions like, tell me about the industry. Who are the key players in the industry if you are new to the industry? But if you're not new to the industry, you might say, what are the key challenges that you see coming on the horizon in the industry? But you also want to be careful about these questions because you don't want to stump these folks. So try to find a nice balance. Then you want to get a list of target organizations for further information. So if you're meeting with these people and they say, you know, again, put this company on your list, you want to put that down and make sure you note that you're going to follow up with the person. So let them know how that works. Ask the referral if the rapport is good. And remember, there's no job. So if you talk to that person and you deem that the relationship is going well, ask them if you can stay in touch with them. Ask them if it's okay to follow up with them in the future. And make sure that you do. I actually have a rule that three times is a charm. And the first time after these informational interviews, I would follow up with these folks and I would say, thank you so much for meeting with me. This has been a great conversation. I just wanted to tell you how much I appreciate it. So the first conversation is just a thank you. The second time you follow up with that person, it's more of a, you know, all about them. You're just going to add value. So you're going to find some kind of link or article of interest that you think would be relevant to that person. But the second time, you don't talk at all about yourself and all about your job search. So it's all about adding value. So you just send an email and say, you know, I saw this. I thought this would be of interest to you. Enjoy. The third time you follow up with that person, you definitely want to say to them, you know, I really appreciate your suggestions. And here's what I've done with those suggestions. Here's how I have put those to use in my job search. And then thank them again and ask them if you can continue to remain in touch. So sort of three-prong approach to following up with these contacts. And then I sort of look at this slide as a lather, rinse, and repeat. Because what you want to do is you want to continue to refine this protocol of being the go-to expert. You want to become an insider by conducting more and more informational interviews, regardless of whether the company is hiring or not. You want to try to impress the hiring manager by knowing these industry secrets. You want to subscribe to the newsletters that are appropriate for your function and for your industry. You can subscribe to RSS feeds of popular blogs, read trade journals, attend webinars, stay abreast of current events in your field, setting Google alerts. If anyone's not using Google alerts, this is a really big thing that can change your search. You know, you can put a Google alert for really anything you want. You can set it for yourself, your name, so you know when anytime your name comes up in the news. You can set it for someone with whom you're having an informational interview. You can set a Google alert for a company. And what will happen is that information will be scoured on the internet and will come to you in a daily digest, so you don't have to go searching for it. So if you have a meeting with a key player at one of your target companies and you have an informational interview the next day, you'll get information the night before about anything that's being said about that organization online. Also, you can follow key players in your industry via Twitter or via LinkedIn influencer. And as you go about these informational interviews, you refine your message and you discover what is unique about your industry, about your function, and about you. And you apply that to your pitch, you apply that to the target companies, you apply that to your list, and you really refine your job search. At the very end of your search, there's something called measuring your search. And this is from the 5 O'Clock Club, an organization called the 5 O'Clock Club, which is a research-based organization. This is one of the things that I use with my clients every single time I coach with them, in addition to the personal marketing plan. So when you have created this plan and you have started to make connections, this is a wonderful way to measure the effectiveness of your search. Are you having success in your search or are you not? And the way to know is that you divide your contacts into 1, 2, and 3, stage 1, 2, and 3. Stage 1 is the beginning of your search, 2 the middle, and 3 the end. first stage is a person that you're meeting with, but you don't really yet have a close relationship with them. They could be people in your target companies, in your target industry, but if you plan to keep in touch with them, they belong on this list. This is still the beginning of your search. So this is when you're going to the networking events. You could be going to, you know, DC Connections or DC Web Women or a Georgetown alum event. But if you're meeting people that you plan to keep in touch with for whatever reason, either they're in an industry you like or they're in one of your target companies, put them on your list. That person belongs on your list. The goal in stage one is to get a lot of contacts with people who are really in the right place where you want to work. 10 or more people who you plan to stay in touch with on an ongoing basis. Stage two belongs to a contact that is at the right level in the right company, and they are becoming an advocate for you. So this is a result of multiple informational interviews. You've been going on these interviews, you've been having success, you've been creating relationships with these people, and now you're hearing them say, this is the key thing, you're hearing them say, I really like you, I really want you to work here, I don't have anything for you today, but if there was something, I would hire you in a minute. When you hear them say something like that, you have effectively moved them from stage one to stage two, and you can put their name in the stage two column. You want to also have 6 to 10 of those. This one document is so transformative because at this point, now you know who you really need to stay in contact with in your stage two. So stage three is when you're moving along the lines of a real job or the possibility of a real job. This is the end of your search, and you want to have 6 to 10 people also in the end of your search. So, of course, you want to have 6 to 10 people there. How do you get them there? Well, you continue to build the pipeline in stage one by going to networking events with people that swim where you want to swim. So basically, if you're looking for a marketing job, you're going to go to marketing associations. If you're looking for a legal job, you're going to network with people in legal. If you're looking for a job in the environmental space, you're going to go to Eco Women or another association that's focused on that. So then you're going to really create and harness those relationships and move them to stage two by continuing to stay in touch with them. And then eventually, when a job does open, that's when you get an interview for it. So now you're not one of the 75 that's searching for the job on the outside. You are now one of the 3 to 5 that are being called in for an interview. So you've effectively become an insider. What I love about this search document, and if you do nothing else, implement the PMP and implement the search document. This measure your search document will allow you to stay positive throughout your search. Because honestly, it's hard to get a job. It's not fun. And you always think you're not doing a great job until you get that offer. But this will allow you to see in black and white that you are making a ton of progress. This becomes an absolutely evolving, you know, incredible document. And when you look at it, you can see that you're making progress because you had very few in stage one, and now you have multiple in stage two, one in stage three, and you just keep building your pipeline left to right, left to right. So as we finalize the webinar, I just have one more thing to share with you, and that is things are going to go wrong. Okay, I really just want you to know that this process is not easy. Okay, I know it's going to be hard to put down the computer and stop applying for jobs online, but this works far better than any other protocol or any spending hours and hours, day and night applying for jobs. Essentially, the gated job market is another term for networking, but I'm just teaching you how to do it very specifically. But when you run into problems, which you might, here's how you could troubleshoot. Here are the challenges that I see mostly when I speak with my clients. Not enough targets. You're targeting less than 10 companies instead of approximately 40. This happens all the time. You think, oh, but you know, there's only a few companies I really, really want to work for. And so you don't maybe write them down on paper, you don't put a personal marketing plan together, and you think that there are far more companies than you actually have. So not having enough targets is probably the number one biggest problem that I see. The number two biggest problem is having too few targets, too few companies, but thinking that there's so many different positions that you could do in those companies. And so your niche is not narrow enough for recruiters to know where to place you. I'll give you an example, World Bank. Practically every position in the World Bank is a program officer. Program officer. You're a program officer of this sector or that sector or this sector or that sector. But your niche is not narrow enough. You just want to work for the World Bank, right? This is a company that you can get into trouble, an organization that sometimes I see people get in trouble with, and one similar to this, because the niche is not narrow enough, and so recruiters just don't know where to place you. By saying program officer, there are still 20 different jobs that could mean, and so people aren't quite clear on what it is you want to do. The other bit of troubleshooting, the problem I see often, is getting back into a rut of applying to posted jobs, even though I suggest not doing so. It's okay, it's going to happen, forgive yourself and just move on, but really try not to spend more than 5 to 10% of your job search time on applying to posted jobs. Being too broad with industries or locations. So this could look like, I'll work anywhere, or I only want to work within 5 minutes of my house. So this is too narrow or too broad. The other one is not building a pipeline of stage one contacts. So not knowing enough people that are relevant for your search. I see this a lot when I work with clients who just want to go to lunch with anybody. You know, anybody wants to network them. Oh, let's go to lunch. Oh, let's meet here. Oh, let's, you know, have job search buddies. Let's go to job clubs. And they're a little bit unfocused with their search. The goal of stage one people is that they are really focused. They're either in your function or they're in your industry. Hopefully, they're actually in your target company. You just don't know them yet well. So not building a big enough pipeline into stage one is also another challenge that I see. And then the last thing, again, just go easy on yourself. If you have experienced any of these issues, it's really important to just pick yourself back up, dust off your PMP, and try again. And if I give you one bit of advice on this webinar, it's do not rely on online job postings, and do not rely just on your resume. Creating a personal marketing plan can be the single most important thing you do in your job search, because it will transform the quality of the conversations you have with your network, and they will allow you to, that you will allow them to help you. You will be teaching them how to help you better. So having said that, I'm going to open the floor to questions, but I just want to tell you very quickly about an opportunity that I just launched, and that is there's a special offer for a brand new course that I just wrote, actually, with Pearson Publishing, which is they're a publishing company, and they're in the Fortune 500. This is an online do-it-yourself job search course. So if you've liked what I've said today and you think it's cutting edge and different and believe it will work, which I know it will, I have a 40-hour course that I just wrote. It's like a graduate course in job search, and it's online, it's do-it-yourself, it's the very same coaching that I give my clients over a 5-session period for the less than a cost private coaching. And it will shave months off your job search. But for just these folks on the call, the Georgetown alum who registered for this call, and because we just launched this course literally 2 weeks ago, I haven't even sold it to the public yet. This is the first time I've even mentioned it. It's $197 instead of $397. So if you're a do-it-yourself person, you are busy, you just want to take a course in job search written by me on how to do it right and how to get a job in half the amount of time, email me, Laura@thecareerstrategygroup.com, with the subject hired and with your first and last name, and we'll talk about getting you access to the course. Okay. So having said that, are there any questions?
Thank you so much, Laura. Yes, we have many questions, so everyone feel free to type in anything you'd like to ask. We'll try and get to as many as possible. So we have someone here who wants to know how you can leverage the LinkedIn factor for your job search. And I will say, Laura, if you don't want to speak to LinkedIn too much, we will be doing future webinars on this.
Okay. I'm happy to address it. Obviously, great question. You want to be using LinkedIn. I suggest people use it, you know, at least 15 minutes a day. One of the ways that I leverage it is, the first thing is obviously you want to create your target list and you want to find out who you know within those companies that you're connected with. So again, let's say you're looking to work for a company in Maryland. You program it into LinkedIn and you see if you have any first or second tier connections, and then you ask for an introduction through them. The other thing is, I think people worry a lot about getting more connections through LinkedIn. There's always this, you need more. When we're really not cultivating the network that we've got. And so ideally, we would be going online to LinkedIn, into the groups, into, you know, going online every day and looking at the news feed and seeing what's going on and commenting on things that people post. Congratulating your network on any kind of change that they've had, a promotion or a title change. A work anniversary. Those are ways to cultivate your network. And then, of course, lastly, is to update your status pretty much on an ongoing basis, regular basis, with only on-brand pieces of information. So if you're going for a job in sustainability, you want to set a Google alert so that you get anything that's on sustainability, and then you want to look at those articles, and if there's anything interesting, you want to post them to LinkedIn. Okay, so that's probably one of the protocols I would use for LinkedIn. I could obviously go on and on and on, but I hope that helps.
Okay, great. And do you have specific suggestions for women or men who have taken time out from the workforce to raise children and are now reentering? And I will also say we recently did a webinar on this as well, so you can find that on our webinar archive.
Specific advice. You know, this is similar to a bit of a career change. And what I tell career changers and return to work mom and dads is to be clear about what it is you want to do next. You will unwillingly prolong your job search and or sabotage your job search if you don't know what you want to do. And so the question really is, ask yourself, do I want to do the same thing I did when I left the workforce? If the answer is yes, then you want to start sort of ramping up those contacts again that you once had. You want to start joining associations that are relevant to that industry. You want to start reading the trade journals you read while you were in business, and you want to get your resume together. The gap is less important to me than I think it is to most job seekers. I've just seen so much success, especially lately, of people getting jobs. You know, I did help someone recently who left the workforce for 12 years, and she got a job at the same level, really just doing some of the same things we're talking about here. So again, if you want to do the same thing, it's just immersing yourself back into the culture you were in before and getting very clear that you want to do that. If you don't want to do that, you know, perhaps the help of a career coach, someone who does career exploration who can help you really figure out what it is you want to do. But once you've figured that out, again, you want to become an insider. And so where do those people hang out? Is there a certification you now need to get? Is there a new legislation that impacts your job? So you need to get back into the frame of thinking like you're a business, you know, you're in that business, and find out what you've missed. And then start targeting the people in those industries and the people in the companies that you want to work for. And there's no shame in going back to the workforce after raising kids. So the bottom line is, keep your head up. You've done nothing wrong. You've done something wonderful, in fact. And that gap has rejuvenated you in many cases. And so, you know, just get real focused on becoming an insider again, and you'll see that good things will happen.
And if someone passes a job opportunity to you and maybe even offers to help you make a connection, but you're not interested in that specific opportunity, what's the best way to respond to still show your gratitude and encourage that person to keep passing on leads, but not necessarily take them up on this offer?
I think it's a perfect opportunity to educate them and obviously thank them and tell them how grateful you are. One thing I would do is say, you know, I probably wasn't clear about the job that I was looking for, and then attach your personal marketing plan so that next time they send you a lead, they can see what it is exactly you're looking for. But tell them, really grateful, thank you so much. I'm actually looking for more of this than this. But this looks like a great job, and maybe I have someone in my network who I can forward this on to if you'd be amenable to that. So I have done that before. If there's a job that comes my way, you know, listen, I don't know anyone, but I may be able to find someone for you. If you'd be open to that, let me know. And again, this is another way to help the people you know find a great opening, and then you're helping them, and karma just sort of goes around. So I think that as long as you're grateful, as long as you're appreciative, and then just use it as an opportunity to, you know, give them a little bit of feedback on, hey, I'm sort of looking for more of this than that.
Okay, and what are your thoughts on recruiters and headhunters and how they factor into your job search?
Great question. Headhunters are great if you are what I call a round peg in a round hole. So if you are a executive in supply chain management, then you can find a search firm that does supply chain management executive positions, and they will love, love, love to speak with you. But if you are an executive in supply chain management and you want to now move to finance, and you're new to finance, a search firm is not going to help you because they get client opportunities. And when they present candidates to their corporate clients, they want it to be, in their opinion, a slam dunk. Okay? So they're not going to look for people necessarily who are on the fringe of a job or a career changer. But once you have a good proven track record of 3 to 5 years of experience in one industry, you could certainly approach headhunters, whether or not they have a job, and say, hey, let's get together. I just want to introduce myself and share with you what I'm about. And I know you may not have anything for me right now, but maybe you will later. But really, you need to wait until you sort of have that track record.
Okay. And what are your tips for someone who graduated during the beginning of the recession, 2007, 2008, and still feels like they're in this cycle of underemployed? So I'm assuming that person means, and please correct me if I'm wrong, that you aren't in a job that's realized your full potential, but you feel like you aren't qualified enough to apply for the jobs that you want.
Probably a tough question to answer in a short period of time, to answer the underemployed question. I think, you know, there's so many variables there, Sarah. I don't know if this person, you know, if the job that they want is in the company and they're just not being, I probably don't know. There's probably too much. I think we should probably ask a different one.
Okay, great. So if you could, you can always reach out to Laura afterwards.
Yes, please.
So what do you do if you're getting first round interviews with recruiters and getting good feedback but are not being asked for second interviews? We have someone here who's a career changer and trying to leverage experience in one field to go into a different field.
So this is a career changer. They're getting good feedback on the first interview, but not on the second interview.
They're not getting asked back for second round interviews, but okay. I apparently haven't heard exactly why.
I'm going to assume that this person hasn't opened the dialogue with the interviewers to ask what's going on in those interviews, because that is totally acceptable to do. And the way that you do that, in case this person has not done that, I'm just going to give you an idea of how to do this. There's a right way and a wrong way to ask for feedback on an interview. The wrong way is to go in with, hire me, why didn't you hire me? Obviously, you wouldn't do that. But if they sense that you're sort of desperate and you still want to try to convince them that you're the right candidate, then that's not the way to do it. But if you go into it like, I totally understand you have hired somebody else, I get it, I would love to use this as an opportunity to learn about how I can potentially do something different for another company. I really would just appreciate your feedback. So if this person hasn't done that, I would definitely start there.
Great. And how would you recommend implementing this strategy if you want to stay at the same company but you want to move divisions or positions?
Same company but want to move positions or divisions. So this would be, you know, career management. It's getting clear on the job that you want inside the company and going to your boss, assuming you have a good relationship with them, and making a plan for getting that position. I don't know if this is a lateral, if it's a promotion. If it's a lateral in another division and the policy is that we allow people to move around, then it could be as simple as, you know, coming up with a 6 month to a year strategy for how to get that job if you have a supportive boss. If you don't have a supportive boss, then you may want to network with some of the people in that department a little bit more stealth-like. You know, go to some networking events where that person hangs out, or reach out to them privately on LinkedIn or via corporate email and say, listen, you know, I would love to work in your company. This is a secret. But that often is a scary way to go, because there are some companies who mandate that if you interview for a job, you have to tell your boss. And so I always say it's just best to be, you know, to be honest and to say, listen, you know, I love what I'm doing, but I'm not challenged, and I think I could do this for another year and really do a great job, but at some point, here's my long-term goal, and, you know, hopefully, nice boss, will you help me get there?
Right. Okay. And what is your advice for people who are introverts? Because we have someone here who feels like this advice is geared towards extroverts, and maybe you just have to say that all job seekers need to be extroverts for a little while.
You know, I feel for the introvert. I've become so much more of an introvert, believe it or not, as I got older. And I really do understand that this is a challenging protocol for introverts. But I will say that it doesn't have to be super daunting if you get a referral by a friend. So I would say that instead of, I wouldn't start with cold calling, for example. I wouldn't start with sort of networking without a friend. I wouldn't go to networking events without maybe a script that you're comfortable with saying, sort of like a 30-second pitch. That way you're going there prepared. You know, you want to use this protocol, okay? At the end of the day, this is how you get a job 90% of the time. But there are ways to do it and sort of ease into it. So, for example, if you're asking for leads and you have a list of target companies, you know, you always want to start with the people who know you better than you start with people who don't know you at all. So if you're asking your neighbors, your friends to give you an introduction, maybe they warm it up a little bit by sending an email to you and to that person and make that warm lead via email. That makes it a little more comfortable. And then you could probably do it over the phone if you wanted to have the conversation, but at some point there is going to probably be a face-to-face. But, you know, I think that, no, you don't have to do cold calling and you don't have to, you know, do as many networking events, but it is important to use this protocol, but use it in a way that's comfortable for you. You know, again, if you get 50% of the way there instead of 100%, but you're doing 50% less applying for jobs, that's still great. That's still progress.
And for people who don't necessarily seek out friendships with their coworkers, and so they don't feel like they have as solid of a network, would you just suggest, you know, sucking it up and making friends with coworkers while you're in a job so that you have them to turn to later on?
You know, no, not disingenuously. I wouldn't. I would make relationships with whomever I'm close with. But because that's where you're going to need to create a network when you job search. But yes, ideally, you know, while you're working, it is better to, again, dig the well when you're not thirsty, right? You know, so making connections while you're currently employed so that you ever do lose your job, you can contact those people and they can help you. It's not a bad idea for sure. But having this on your radar so you're always sort of making connections wherever you go is a good idea anyways, but it doesn't have to be your coworkers. You know, it can be the people you bowl with, people at your alumni, you know, people at Georgetown, former professors, your religious, you know, a rabbi or a priest. So it doesn't have to necessarily be your coworkers if you're sort of, you know, keep to yourself at work. But you do want to sort of keep an eye, especially when you're not job searching, on what does my network look like, and you want to cultivate that, which means staying in touch with people. Don't lose touch. You know, making sure you stay top of mind, you know, asking them what's going on with them, asking how you can help them, that sort of thing.
And if you are looking for a CEO position, how should you adjust your personal marketing plan? Do you look at firms where you feel the CEO may be retiring soon?
Yes, you do. You absolutely do. You keep your eye on companies where things are potentially not doing so well. You know, their numbers aren't so good. Their divisions are being cut. You know, maybe they acquired a business unit and that business unit is you know, being spun off. So these are like trouble spots. These are called catalyst events, and that's often a great place for a CEO to sort of get a seat at the table. And then also marketing to the board of directors is a great way for a CEO to get a spot.
Okay. And we have someone here who has requested informational interviews but gets the response, sorry, we're not hiring right now. Keep an eye on our website. So how should he respond? That's not the point of an informational interview.
Exactly. You know, that's great. Thanks for telling me. And when you do hire, I'm sure I'll be interested, but I'm not looking for a job right this minute. I just want information. And if it's not you, is there someone else in the company who you can direct me to?
All right, great. And if you narrow your target positions or sectors or areas versus saying, I'll work at a number of positions at the World Bank, might you not exclude yourself from other jobs you might have been qualified for because you left them off your target list?
This is always the biggest concern when I speak to my clients is, will I pigeonhole myself? At the end of the day, the risk of pigeonholing yourself is much lower than the risk of being too broad and having the recruiter have no idea where to put you. And so, yes, you might. That's the truth. But it's very rare for that to happen because a recruiter that sees a candidate that knows exactly what they want to do, that has a resume that says, this is what I want to do with the target and the function and maybe even potentially an industry, they look very, very focused and they look very attractive.
Okay. Well, Laura, we have so many fantastic questions, but I know we are at time. Do you mind if we do one more?
No, it's fine. You can ask a couple more if you want.
All right, perfect. And thank you, everyone, for the great questions. So since in-person networking is, you're usually told that that's more productive and you should try to take someone for coffee or a drink, but that can be difficult when you're actually working a full-time job. So do you think it's acceptable and as effective to conduct informational interviews over the phone?
I think it's necessary. I think it's absolutely necessary for people who are employed. And do not worry that you're not getting a face-to-face. You can absolutely build a friendship with people. I mean, look at Twitter. People are, you know, talking to people all hours of the night that they're, you know, they're on different continents and they're good friends. So they're not even on the phone. They're just on the computer. And so you absolutely can make a connection over the phone. And, you know, half of my staff I've never met in person. So I think it's a perfectly acceptable, suitable way, especially for someone who's employed.
Okay, great. And we have someone here who is a lawyer and finds that most hiring decision makers only want people with big firm experience. So do you have any suggestions for how to get around that requirement?
Yes, don't apply for a job, because once they post the job, they're going to have on there big firm experience. And then they're going to look at them and they don't have big firm experience. And I mean, the thing is, I would find companies and people in those companies who didn't have big firm experience and find out what they did. So, you know, if you're networking, you know, come across people in legal, start asking them, you know, what was your background? And especially people who are doing what it is you want to do, the informational interviews will now look like, okay, so you didn't have big firm experience, so how did you break into the company you're in? Give me a step-by-step, give me a play-by-play, and then start getting some themes. I'm sure some themes will emerge between those people you speak with, and then start making a plan based on that.
Okay. And so we have a lot of questions here, again, around LinkedIn and reaching out to second or third level connections, or even a fellow alumnus that's not a connection. How do you do that without sounding annoying or strange or needy? And by the way, I will tell everyone, I highly suggest you reach out to other alums on LinkedIn. I don't care if you're connected. You're connected through the university, so that's good enough. But Laura, I'd love to hear
you. I love that you said needy, because if you're not talking about a job, right? If there's no job opening at the time, it's actually the perfect time to have an informational interview. Once the job is open, you meeting with them or asking for a meeting becomes self-serving, right? It becomes, you know, how can you help me? Whereas if you're going in like, this is a cool company, I think it's awesome that you work here, you know, you're a Georgetown alum, I'm a Georgetown alum, you know, just from one Georgetown alum to another, can you tell me what it's like to work here? You know, there's nothing available right now. I just would love your feedback. And also, you know, you've really worked your way up in this company, you know, how did you do it? Any specific advice? And that's really the way to not sound desperate, to not sound needy. And I have found that most people like to talk about themselves, and that if you're not asking for a job, they don't feel put upon, right? They don't feel used, because you're not just talking to them to get a job. You can even say, you know, I'm not looking for a job at this moment, or I'm just doing my research because the next job I take I want it to be a job that I stay at for a while. And so I'm really doing my due diligence. I'm trying to make sure that the company I tap into is really the one I want to work for. So in terms of being needy, I think it's just about building relationships and building rapport. And it becomes about being curious, right? Not about being a taker.
Okay. And what is your advice for our young alums on the line who don't have much work experience, so they don't have that network of colleagues and they don't have as much to look back on other than their peers from undergrad? How would they go about this?
First of all, I would say it's just really important to get clear on what it is they want to do. And I know I've said that a few times. And then joining associations, professional or otherwise, is a great idea because they can start tapping into the relationships that they build there. You know, I have recommended to many people that they find an association that's either in their industry of choice or in their function of choice. So for example, it would be maybe like a manufacturing industry association would be like the industry association, or maybe an HR association, which would be the function, right? So you could do one or the other or both. And I always say, call the president of the organization and say, I'm about to join. What are the key things that I need to know about this organization? Where can I volunteer? You know, is there a listserv? How can I get to know the maximum amount of people possible? And how can I get involved in the organization fast? You know, maybe there's a conference coming up that you can volunteer at. You know, you could make 100 connections in one day at a conference, and they're all in your industry, right? So they can all potentially be put on your personal marketing plan.
All right, great. And before we leave, do you work with job seekers over 50? Because we do have some people on the line that are having a harder time. They still want to work, but they're having a harder time getting interviews.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yes, I do. I do. I speak at 40 plus of Greater Washington a lot, and they have a great, great toolkit for job seekers over 40. But I absolutely, it's a regular clientele for sure.
Okay, great. And Laura, I'm assuming I might know the answer to this question, but if somebody wants to move to a new city and they don't have any contacts there, because they're in a different city, but they're trying to identify contacts, would their plan change at all, their marketing plan, or how they go about reaching out to people?
So the principles of job search, whether you're searching locally or, you know, across the country, they are the same. Okay, everything on this that we've talked about is the same. The only thing I would add to that is when you're creating sort of your informational interview plan, right, when you're going to meet with your target companies, I would set aside a time. Let's say you're going to California and you're going to go for a week. You know, you're going to set aside a couple days to do those informational interviews or a day or two. And then you want to line up those meetings in advance. And, you know, or you do a lot of them over the phone before you even get there, and then you meet them in person and you sort of get a double whammy. But the principles are really the same. You know, so you could call the Chamber of Commerce there and find out what organizations are locally. You know, if you know exactly, you know, you're going to be in San Diego, you know, call the San Diego Chamber of Commerce and find what companies are in your industry of interest. Start making a list. Find people who you know on LinkedIn. Talk to them on the phone. Say, listen, I'm coming to California in a couple weeks. Can we get together for coffee? You know, or can I just come and meet you for a few minutes? All of the things apply. Same thing applies.
Okay. All right. Well, Laura, thank you so much for staying on the line. And do you have any resources you'd like to share before we jump off?
I mean, obviously, I'm going to share my own resources. My Hired program is phenomenal. It was, you know, a year and a half in the making with Pearson Publishing. It's a, you know, 40-hour job search course. It's really incredible. And when you, you know, when you do it on your own, it can really, you know, improve your job search success. Also, and if you're interested in that, it's going to be on the PowerPoint. You know, my book, 100 Conversations for Career Success, for those introverts that are not sure how to communicate your pitch or how to communicate for those awkward moments in networking that everybody experiences in their job search, that's a great book. Another book is Make Your Contacts Count. That's a terrific networking book also for introverts if they're struggling in their search. Gosh, there's so many resources. I love all the books that the 5 O'Clock Club has, so that's another great resource. So if you look up Kate Wendleton, W-E-N-D-L-E-T-O-N, she's written a bunch of books, and they're all good. But I just also want to say before we close, thank you all for staying on the call, again, for giving your time to this. I really, really appreciate it. It's been an honor to speak to all of you.
Okay. All right. Well, thank you so much. And again, just a reminder, we recorded this webinar. You can watch it tomorrow on our YouTube channel, and you can also check out other webinars we've done in the past related to job search skills. I do want to let everyone know, if you are looking for a position in the entrepreneurial space, so at a startup or small business, we will be having a virtual career fair just for Georgetown alumni on October 29th. So we're getting our employers registered now, and then once we have all of those employers finalized, we will send out an email to the Georgetown alumni community. We'll also post registration on Facebook, Twitter, LinkedIn. So just keep an eye out for that. That's a wonderful place to go and know that these employers specifically want to hire Georgetown alums. Also, keep an eye out for upcoming webinars. Like I said, we'll be doing some things on LinkedIn and building your reputation, personal branding. So these are all things that I think help and relate back to Laura's strategies here today. So thank you, everyone, and best of luck to you in your job search.